political center, scallop capital of the world. Different from your town? Well, yes and no. A West Virginia coal town is different too. So is a Mississippi cotton town, an Oregon lumber town, an iron mining town in Michigan's Upper Peninsula. Yet, not so different, really. It doesn't much matter whether it was the depletion of natural resources, changing technologies and automation, or changing consumer tastes. Cities with all sorts of backgrounds can feel the economic growing pains of an America on the move. The loss of jobs, low wages, the migration of younger people in search of opportunities elsewhere, all these are problems that can be either stumbling blocks or stepping stones. Which they are depends on people. Here in New Bedford, people think of problems as challenges. That's why this is a city on the mend. There's an air of optimism, a feeling of progress in New Bedford. You can feel the tempo of progress in all sorts of new construction. You can measure progress by the new industries that have established here to grow with a growing city. You can be excited by progress when you look at the other new industries that are still coming in. There are other ways to mark a city's progress. Progress is new jobs being created. Progress is new homes being built. Progress is an increase in purchasing power, so vital to our free enterprise economy. But you know, progress doesn't just happen, and there is no magic formula. Progress has its roots in community initiative, many different people working together in many different ways. And progress grows out of a variety of activities, public and private, local, state, and federal. Why is New Bedford's progress and the progress of cities like it so important? Sailors here have a saying that a rising tide lifts all the boats. And this phrase has been used to describe the interdependence that is inherent in our American system. A system which needs healthy local economies to ensure a healthy national economy. Community initiative, the pooling of all available resources. One community's very significant contribution to the rising tide of our economy. These are the subjects of this special report. Redevelopment Act is one of the keystones in the government's total economic program for America. It is designed to help communities that have not realized their full potential, that have not kept pace with the country's general move forward. Through ARA, community leaders have an opportunity to beef up their own efforts with some new economic tools. Low-cost loans for new or expanding firms, financial aid for public facilities that will increase industrial or commercial employment, technical help in developing products, markets, and resources, and a new concept, federal retraining for jobless workers. But these, after all, are just tools, only as effective as the way in which a community uses them. And before local leaders can make the best use of this federal assistance, they need to have some idea of the extent of local problems and their potential solutions. They must have, in short, an inventory of strengths and weaknesses and a blueprint for action. So New Bedford's first step was to bring together a broadly representative local committee, the leaders of industry and labor, educators, bankers, retailers, municipal officials, the movers and shakers of the community. Their job, to draw up what ARA calls an overall economic development program, A road map, if you will, of where the community has been, where it is now, and where it's going. The past was easy to reconstruct. To most Americans, the name New Bedford calls up a host of images of wooden ships and iron men, of Captain Ahab and the great white whale Moby Dick, of the search around the globe for the whale oil that once lit the lamps of the world. The largest whaling fleet in the world once set sail from this great port on Buzzard's Bay. Little more than a century ago, more than half of all America's whaling vessels called New Bedford home. Evidence of this proud era survives. The stately widow's walks, for example, atop many an historic home, from which the women watched and waited for their seafaring men to return. New Bedford's past is captured by the mariner's home on Johnny Cake Hill. Those whaling days are enshrined in the Seaman's Bethel, where the sailors offered prayers for a safe voyage. And they're immortalized in the unique cenotaphs to the men who went down to the seas in ships and who never returned. But times were changing, even a century ago. And the discovery of natural oil in Pennsylvania brought an abrupt end to an era in which New Bedford had boasted the highest per capita income in the nation. So the fires were banked beneath the huge smoky tripods in which whalers had boiled the blubber to extract the oil. The huge vessels swung lazily at their anchors, and the men of New Bedford turned away from the sea to seek their fortune on the land. The textile industry was on the move in America in the middle of the 19th century, and it was largely concentrated in New England. With characteristic determination, the people of New Bedford set out to make their city the center of the industry, and they succeeded. By the late 1920s, New Bedford was the largest spinning center in the United States. Its 70 giant mills were working at full capacity. It led all the nation in the production of fine cotton and yarns. Then came the Depression, and in its restless wake came new changes, the development of synthetic fibers and the migration in the South. At first, only a few of the spindles stopped turning. Then entire plants shut down, and thousands of men and women were without jobs. Finally, only a few companies remain. Another era had come to a close for New Bedford. So much for the past. Having analyzed the cause of the city's decline, the overall Economic Development Committee turned to the present. What, they asked, was the city doing now to stage another comeback?
New Bedford had never completely turned its back on the sea. Some of its men always have been seafarers. And even at the height of the textile era, the fishing industry contributed significantly to the city's economy.
This is the world's scallop center, and 12 months a year, the fishing fleet drags the ocean bottom for this seafood delicacy, while other boats from this port fish for flounder and haddock on the North Atlantic banks. New Bedford handles the largest dollar volume of seafood of any Atlantic coast port in the United States. It is second only to San Pedro in the value of its yearly catch. The seafood industry means work for thousands of people. It means jobs capturing the fish hundreds of miles offshore. It means jobs unloading the catch on the docks. It means jobs in processing plants along the waterfront. It means jobs transporting the fish to the waiting markets of the nation. But important though it is, the seafood industry could never hope to provide jobs enough in this city of 100,000. And anyway, New Bedford wanted something other than a one-industry economy with its pattern of peaks and valleys. So progressive-minded citizens several years ago formed what they called the Greater New Bedford Industrial Foundation. Its purpose, to foster the development of new and diversified industry. More than 100 key civic leaders made up the foundation. They came from labor and management, from local government and the broad field of education, from the professions and retail trade, from the banks and the utilities. Why so broad a representation? Because everyone has a stake in economic development. Because everyone has something to contribute to its success. And they were enthusiastic about what they could do. But it takes more than just enthusiasm to improve a city's economy, to help new firms get started, to help existing firms grow. Among other things, it takes money. The foundation set out to raise funds, $400,000 to be exact. Local businessmen contributed generously to the drive. Private citizens gave too. And in the end, the foundation had collected $600,000, half again as much as it had set out to raise. That was just the beginning. The city government gave a big boost to the campaign for new payrolls when it created an official municipal agency, the New Bedford Industrial Development Commission, to work with new and expanding industry. Its chairman was an official of the trade union movement. Its members included the judge of the district court, representatives of the city's retail stores, a spokesman for industry. Working with a full-time director on the municipal payroll, the commission mapped what it called its pattern for progress, a plan of action to help industry create new jobs in an area sorely in need of more employment. The director's first job was to inventory available plant space that could be offered to firms that needed to locate close to the business district. The next step was to find suitable new sites on the outskirts for firms that would want to build new facilities tailored to particular needs. Again, the city council helped, investing $2 million in the development of an industrial park, putting in roads, sewers, water lines. Private utilities cooperated too, supplying gas and electric service. And new industries began setting up shop in New Bedford, attracted by the vigor with which the city prospected for new payrolls. So the economic development report on the present status of New Bedford read, hopeful. It had started doing something on its own. It had an organization. It had some new plants. Now, with the added tools from ARA, what direction should it be taking for the future? The most important first step, the committee said, was to provide adequate protection against tidal waves. In the hurricanes of 1938 and 1944, and in three more severe storms in the 50s, walls of water had swept in from the sea, flooding plants, smashing the fishing fleet, causing hundreds of millions of dollars in damage. What was needed, they said, was a huge dike to protect the city and its harbor. Next, they said, the whole fishing industry needed modernization, and new docking facilities had to be developed. And something had to be done to improve the network of roads to provide adequate, up-to-date surface connections with other population centers of New England. They sketched out broad plans for a wide-ranging program of urban renewal, to revitalize some rundown residential sections, along with some of the key industrial and commercial areas. The overall economic development program emphasized the need for retraining of idled workers. The textile industry was gone, the old skills of thousands of workers were no longer needed, and their hopes for ever finding jobs in industry again rested on the acquisition of new skills. Finally, the long-range plan for New Bedford called for private action to capitalize on the rapidly growing recreation and tourism industry
an important source of jobs in many areas of the country. A particularly big opportunity in an area that shares the same sea, sand, and sun as does neighboring Cape Cod. That was it, New Bedford. Past, present, future. And when the overall economic development program was completed, New Bedford had laid the groundwork for tying together local, state, and federal activities. For the first time, it had a fully coordinated program to help put the city back on its feet. With its long-range planning completed, the city got down to specifics. One of the first ARA projects launched anywhere in the country was a comprehensive study of New Bedford's seafood industry. Working under an ARA technical assistance contract, one that had been approved by the Interior Department's Bureau of Commercial Fisheries, experts from the New Bedford Institute of Technology went to work. They examined every phase of the industry, from the time the fish are hauled aboard the ships of the New Bedford fleet, through the sale of the daily catch at the historic fish auction, through the unloading of scallops and fish on the piers, to the processing for market. The results of the ARA finance study are having a profound effect on the industry. Its recommendations for newer and more efficient handling methods may soon be adopted by fishermen and processors alike. Its views on the overcrowded docking facilities to handle a fleet that in recent years has grown 400% have been a major spur to community plans to revitalize the entire waterfront. Its recommendations on a vocational education program that will train a new generation in all phases of this important industry are exciting the imaginations of city officials. And when plans materialize, the day may soon come when the descendant of some old-time whaling skipper is enrolled in a course on oceanography at the Institute, studying the mysteries of the seas which his forebears sought to solve a century or more ago. The study of the fishing industry was only one of a long string of benefits New Bedford reaped from the overall economic development program it drew up as a result of ARA. Through the Army's Corps of Engineers, work has begun on a massive $17 million hurricane dike to protect the harbor. First of its kind ever to be built to hold back angry seas. Some people say New Bedford's future begins here, at this huge seawall. ARA investment, plus community and state funds, have helped construct this $500,000 maritime terminal. Carried out in cooperation with the Community Facilities Administration, the project included dredging of a channel for deep draft ocean-going vessels, construction of 3.5 acres of docking space, the building of a new bulkhead. As a result, a $3 million cold storage plant is rising on New Bedford's waterfront, largest private port development on the East Coast. Through the Commerce Department's Bureau of Public Roads, work is progressing on the New Bedford link of Interstate Highway 195. Assuring adequate hookup to the nation's network of modern highways. ARA funds, combined with local bank money, publicly raised funds, and private capital, have helped put a textile firm back into operation, providing jobs again in a business that now turns out synthetic fibers. Still another case, a firm set up operations in New Bedford to manufacture stainless steel sinks, thanks to local efforts and investment augmented by an ARA loan. In both cases, the Small Business Administration worked closely with ARA to make the job-generating projects possible. ARA job retraining projects have helped hundreds of jobless workers learn essential new skills, and with these skills to find new jobs. This phase of the ARA program is carried out through the Department of Labor and the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare, working with local vocational education people and the local Employment Security Office. The men who were retrained and reemployed ranged in age from 21 to 53. Most, it meant learning a new way of life, finding a second chance in the job market. And the 90% placement record, 9 out of 10 trainees back on payrolls in private enterprise, speaks volumes both for the quality of the training and the determination of the men taking the courses. They're so determined, in fact, that many of the ARA graduates are coming back to school on their own, signing up for additional night courses to learn more about their new trades. And there's more ahead for New Bedford. It will shortly embark on a large-scale effort under the Urban Renewal Administration, an agency whose program was liberalized under the Area Redevelopment Act to put an added tool in the hands of hard-hit areas. First step, to which the federal government has already committed $6 million, and to which New Bedford and the state of Massachusetts will each add another million, calls for a huge new fishing pier, construction of bulkheads behind which will stretch 400 additional acres of newly usable land, and the dredging of a deeper channel. As the ARA finance study of the fishing industry pointed out, this will mean three times as much docking space and is expected to lead to construction of a cluster of new fish processing plants. Next step will be another terminal to serve the deep draft tuna boats that are putting into New Bedford with greater frequency each year. And that in turn may lead to still more processing operations here. New Bedford is planning on a $60 million, 10-year urban renewal program. And they are following the guidelines laid down in the overall economic development program. Economic renewal first, to be followed in stages by development of middle-income housing, parks, playgrounds, schools. But not all of the old buildings will give way to the need for modernization. In the heart of the urban renewal area, the Whaling Museum, the Seaman's Bethel, and other historic buildings will be preserved and, when necessary, restored. A private group is raising the funds to see to this historic preservation now. But if New Bedford is holding fast to its ties with yesterday, it is also striding forward into the world of tomorrow. One of its plants, engaged in the exciting field of ceramics, is manufacturing parts for space capsules. After less than a year's operation in New Bedford, it already is considering doubling the size both of its workforce and its plant. Another of the city's newcomers is turning out important parts for the missile program. And the products of still another firm, a longtime employer in New Bedford, were used aboard the Nautilus. Bedford has come a long way indeed from whaling to the nuclear age. It's clear that diversification holds the key to this city's economic progress. From fishing to products for the space age, from cotton and rayon goods to fine tools and metal products, from electronic components to rubber and plastics, New Bedford is building a stronger economic base. one that will better adapt to the changes that the future is certain to bring. Admittedly, New Bedford has a lot going for it. There's a special sort of hardiness in the people who have already stood up to the loss of two different economies in the brief span of a single century. And there's new blood surging through New Bedford's veins. Your old men shall dream dreams, the Bible tells us. Your young men shall see visions. New Bedford's young generation not only sees its visions, it has been given the opportunity to help make these visions come true.
The city's youthful mayor, the industrial development director, the head of the Harbor Development Commission, the vocational education director, the urban renewal director, the redevelopment authority chairman, the study team from the Institute. All these and many more like them are making their contribution to New Bedford's future. More than that, people of all generations, people from all walks of life, are joining enthusiastically in the programs going on here. And the focal point of their activity, it's the overall economic development program drawn up as the first requirement for self-help under the Area Redevelopment Program, giving new strength to the work of existing groups, serving as the source both of ideas and of coordinated planning.
All of this adds up to a rising tide, one that will lift all the economic boats in New Bedford, because new jobs in basic industry mean new jobs in supporting industries, in trades and services. But a rising economic tide in New Bedford or in any other redevelopment area that is on the comeback trail has implications far broader than the narrow boundaries of the community itself. Take people off unemployment compensation rolls or public assistance rolls and put them back on payrolls anywhere in the country, and you start a chain reaction. Put men to work and their families can buy clothing manufactured in Pennsylvania from cloth spun in North Carolina. Automobiles made in Michigan from steel made in Indiana. Oranges grown in Florida and flown north in planes made in California and powered by fuel from Texas. Put men to work somewhere else in the country and they can buy New Bedford scallops and flounder or the countless other products of its diversified industry. Put men to work. That's what they're doing here in New Bedford through the Area Redevelopment Program, which puts its stress on local initiative and the pooling of local, state, and federal resources. And as they put men to work, the rising tide lifts all the boats, everywhere in America.